you, Minister Taylor. Can we clap our hands and tell Jesus, thank you? Amen. Amen, 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 amen. If you have your Bibles, which I believe you do, turn with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 62, because I do believe that's where our text and our theme comes from. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Isn't God good?
Yes.
Praise God. Isaiah chapter 62, in the presence of him who is invisible, for the reading of the word of God. Hallelujah. Thank you. The 62nd chapter of the book of Isaiah. It says that Isaiah is the prophet of the sun. Ezekiel is the prophet of the spirit, and Jeremiah is the prophet of the Father. But Isaiah said, for Zion's sake will I not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until the righteous thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory. And thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Thou shalt no more be termed forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be termed desolate, but thou shalt be called Ephrathah, and thy land Beulah. For the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. Verse 5, for as a young man marrieth a virgin, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as the bridegroom rejoiceth over the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee. And we'll stop at number 6. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace, day nor night, yet ye that make mention of the Lord keep not silent. Shall we pray? God our Father, we thank you for being God in our lives. We thank you that before the foundation of the world were that you are. There's nothing impossible with you. And because of that, we honor thy great name. Thy word is already anointed. So your word don't need no anointing. It is already anointed. It is the servant of God that needs the anointing tonight. So Lord, we thank you for this great convention, and for what you have already started, and for what you will complete. And we praise you, and we thank you, and the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Before you have your seat, we will revisit the 6th verse. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace. Turn to somebody and say, never hold your peace.
Never hold your peace.
Say it again.
Never hold your peace.
Say it again.
Never hold your peace.
Say it again.
Never hold your peace.
I'm going to ask you, gentlemen, if you would please help me with the instrument tonight because of my throat. I would really appreciate that. Shake somebody's hand and you may have a seat. Thank you. Never hold your peace. When we look at Zion, Zion it said, was a hill in Jerusalem on which the temple was built. It was used to symbolize the city itself, especially as a religious or spiritual center. The next definition for Zion is the Jewish people. Next definition is Palestine as the Jewish homeland and symbol of Judaism. And there's a definition that says heaven has the final gathering place of true believers. And the final definition I picked out was the hill of Jerusalem on which the city of David was built. But I would like to borrow verse 6 tonight, and I would like to tie all of that in with the theme that says, for Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace. And I would tonight like to refer to Zion not as a city. Not even, I would like to use the meaning, not as a city or even heaven, but I would like to utilize the meaning that centers around the Jewish people. I'd like to use that tonight as a people. But if you would indulge me and turn to First Chronicles chapter 9, and let us see how much we can tie in the Word of God and see where we will go tonight. First Chronicles chapter 9. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. In 1 Chronicles chapter 9, if you would indulge me in a couple of verses from verse 17, I probably wouldn't have time tonight to explain all of what I would like to, but if you would read and study, then you would get your own revelation or explanation of the scriptures. Somebody say amen. Amen. In verse 17, the Bible says, and the porters were Shalom and Akob and Talman and Amenia and their brethren. Shalom was the chief, who hitherto waited in the king's gate eastward. They were porters in the companies of the children of Levi. And Shalom, the son of Korah, the son of Ibisaph, the son of Korah and his brethren of the house of his father, the Korahites, were over the work of the service, keepers of the gates of the tabernacle, and their fathers, being over the host of the Lord, were keepers of the entrance. And Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, was the ruler over them in time past, and the Lord was with them. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And it goes on, and it jumped down to verse 22, and it tells you that all these were chosen to be porters. In the gates were 212. These were reckoned by their genealogies in their villages, whom David and Samuel the seer did ordain in their set office. So they and their children had the oversight of the gates of the house of the Lord, namely the house of the tabernacle by wards. In four quarters were the porters toward the east, west, north, and south, and their brethren which were in their villages were to come after 7 days from time to time with them. For these Levites, the four chief porters were in their set office and were over the chambers and treasuries of the house of God. And you could read on, and you could stop at verse 32. But the reason why I read all of those scriptures tonight, we're going to try, Bishop, to see if we can tie the Word of God together to show you how important it is for the people of God to not hold their peace, but to get a hold of what we call intercessory prayer. Are you listening to me? Because if truth be told, many of the people of God today have ceased praying. If truth be told, God is searching for watchmen. If truth be told, those who are supposed to be watching in Zion have become complacent. I don't hear nobody saying anything. If truth be told, the watchmen are not even watching, but they have become complacent, and not even complacent, but we have become lazy. Now, when you understand the Word of God, when He said, I have set watchmen, and then when David and Samuel the prophet begin to ordain and to set watchmen over different parts of the temple or the different parts of the gate, and we call them gatekeepers. Hiya. Somebody say gatekeepers. Now you have to understand, beloved, that being a gatekeeper is a strange responsibility. Not only that being a gatekeeper is a strange responsibility, it is an awesome job. Because being a gatekeeper, you determine who goes in and you determine who comes out. So, we're going to find out tonight who really has the ministry of intercession. Because it is with that ministry, and we're going to tie this in tonight and to find out if the gatekeepers are really keeping gate or we're just standing guard. When David, he was the one who set or put the gatekeepers in their places, and their calling was officially confirmed by Samuel the prophet or the seer. King David in the scripture we just read represent Christ in the story that we just read, and Samuel represents the Holy Spirit, and Christ is the king or head of his church. And this ministry, as you read, where the Bible said David set porters, or he set gatekeepers, or I, for a want for a better word, I call them, Bishop, prophetic intercessors. Intercessors who has the heart of God. Intercessors who know the times and the seasons. Intercessors who understand where God is going. And intercessors who are in tune with the Holy Ghost, who have a ear to hear and have a heart to understand. They can understand where the Spirit is going. Because what they have, what these gatekeepers have, and what these intercessors have, and what these porters have, and what we need to have, is not really a whole lot of noise. But Jesus says, he that has ears to hear, let him hear. Touch your ears and say, God, give me ears to hear. Because some people are hearing, but we don't know what they're hearing. But we need to hear what he is saying. And when we hear what he's saying, that we will understand where he's going. And when we understand where he's going, then we will have a clear direction how to follow. But if we don't understand where he's going, and if we are not gatekeepers, if we are not porters, if we are not prophetic intercessors, then all we do is just mark time. We're going someplace. If I can get help, Bishop, with these instruments. If I can get some help. If I can really get some help. Because we come to preach tonight. That's what we really come to do. And if we come to preach, we need sound to preach. Are you listening to me? And so when David set these porters and the prophet sanctioned it by the Holy Ghost. Now the duties of the gatekeeper are the intercessors. They were appointed and they were put in their place. And certain tasks were given to them. And you have to read what we just read to understand. And so we know that the prophetic intercessors, they each have received specific tasks from the Lord. The gatekeepers were placed at every gate. They were placed at every gate. The entrances of the tent of meetings on the four sides, the east, the west, the north and the south, and they were placed at every gate. There is a reason, Bishop, why the intercessors are the gatekeepers were placed at every gate. Because you've got to understand in this strategic time and what God is doing in these last days, he has to have strategic prophetic people who know the times and seasons, who knows how to pray, who knows how to seek God. I don't hear nobody say anything. Even God has to have people who will not hold their peace. Who will not hold their peace. But they will stand as prophetic intercessors. And they will say, God, I'm going to give you no rest until I'm going to stay until I'm going to pray. Lift your hand and say, Lord, make me an intercessor. Bishop, we're going someplace. We are going someplace. But God said, I've said, now watch this. God said, I've set watchmen. I have set watchmen. What does watchmen do? Watchmen watch. Not only that, watchmen watch. Watchmen are keepers of the gate. They make sure they know who comes in and they make sure what goes out. They know who goes out and they know who comes in. And so we call them prophetic intercessors. They were keepers of the gate. They were positioned on every side of the gate, the east and the west and the north and the south. And they have certain responsibilities. Stability. And we're going to tie this in tonight because God said, I've set watchmen upon the wall. You see, beloved, we are in a church today where the church is just lagging behind because most people in the church don't even understand what is happening and
and we go to church, but we don't understand what is happening. We worship, but we don't understand what is happening. We say a prayer, but we don't understand what is happening. But God said, I'm looking for some people who will become intercessors, who will be positioned at the gate, and who will not hold your peace, but who will cry out, because for Zion's sake, for Zion's sake, for Zion's sake, for Zion's sake, I'm gonna put somebody shout, hold not your peace. Are you listening to me? And so we're going somewhere, just bear with me. But there were certain intercessors that they were called chief gatekeepers. Come on, Bishop, can I preach some up in here? They were chief gatekeepers. They were responsible. Their responsibility was great. And so, do you know why God will delay judgment? It is not because of the prime minister. It's because of the gatekeepers. It's because of the intercessors. It's because of those who know how to stay on their knees before God until Shiloh comes. It's because of those who know that said, God, I'm going to give you no rest until you make Jerusalem a praise. It's because of the gatekeepers that will not move from the gate. And what God is looking for is some gatekeepers who will say, God, I'm gonna hold my position. I will not move under a shot. I will not move, but I'm gonna hold my position. Let hell belch, let demons vomit, but I'm gonna hold my position, because I am a prophetic intercessor. I am a gatekeeper. I'm gonna make sure no devil comes in. I don't hear nobody saying anything, but I'm gonna stay until God. Are you listening to me? Somebody shout prophetic intercessors. Shout prophetic intercessors. What is God looking for? You see, some of these intercessors, they were chief gatekeepers. You know, God has given responsibilities to the church, but there are some people that are chief gatekeepers. They had the responsibilities, and when you read the scriptures, they had the responsibility for the rooms and the treasures in the house of God. Those gatekeepers would spend the night stationed around the house of God. They would spend the night. They would spend the night. They would move. They would move. Do you know that as an intercessor, you can stop the judgment of God? As an intercessor, you can prevent dangerous things from happening in the house of God. As an intercessor, that you can stop devils in the tracks. As an intercessor, God will show you his mind. God will show you his heart. God will show you what to pray. He will place people on your heart. But you have got to want to see God move. You have got to want to see the Holy Ghost move. You have got to want that, so you cannot be complacent. You have got to say, God, I will not hold my peace until... Bishop, we're going someplace. And so, they spend the night stationed around the house of God because they had to guard it. Tell somebody, I said, guard the house of God. Guard it from false spirit. Can I talk to you? Guard it from false doctrine. Guard it from the occult. Guard the house of God. But if you're not a prophetic intercessor, if you're not a gatekeeper, there's not much guarding you can do, because you got to spend the night. I don't hear nobody saying anything. You've got to spend the night around the house of God. And so sometimes being an intercessor, it calls for sleepless nights. It calls for fasting and prayer. It calls for sacrifice. It calls for you to say, God, I've got to guard this house from false prophet. I've got to guard this house from demonic oppression. And so, God, I'm going to stay right here. I'm not going to give up. I will not hold my peace. I will not keep silent, because I am stationed at one of these entrances. I am one of these prophetic intercessors that's gonna stay until. Hallelujah. So let me show you how they had to guard it. They opened the gates each morning. And this, I believe, Bishop, represents the assignment to pray specifically for the ministries of the church and for the finances of the church. I believe that God has given to some intercessors special faith to believe in for the financial breakthroughs that are needed to do specific things in the house of God. Now, there are certain people that had certain names, and their names were significant. And the reason why God allowed David to set up those certain people over certain place, and when you understand what their names meant, then you would understand the prophetic intercessory ministry. Shalom of the Korahites and some of his relatives, they were responsible for guarding the thresholds of the tent. They were continuing the ministry of their fathers, who had been keepers of the entrance of the Lord's camp. I don't hear nobody saying anything. Listen, what God does, he trusts you so much that he sets you up to guard the entrance of the camp. And because he knows that you're a prophetic intercessor, he said, listen, I know you're flesh and blood, but I'm trusting you to guard the entrance. I don't hear nobody saying anything. You see, when God can trust you to guard the entrance, it means he has given you special ability. It means he has anointed you. It means that he has touched you. It means that his favor is upon your life. So he gives you special ability. He said, stay right here and guard the entrance of the camp, because I trust you, because you're a gatekeeper. Talk to somebody and tell them, I am a gatekeeper. You are a gatekeeper. And being a gatekeeper, it's an awesome responsibility. Listen to me. The keepers of the entrance of the camp, they had to keep watch over the coming in and the going out of the tent of meeting during the day. And some of them were in charge of the articles that used in the temple service. Others were assigned to take care of the furnitures and all the other articles of the sanctuary. The firstborn of Shalom had the responsibility of the bakery, and some of his relatives were responsible for the shewbread. In addition, we see that there were some gatekeepers or intercessors or prophetic intercessors who were in charge of guarding the temple from any impurities. And the Bible said he set portals at the gates of the house of God that none would which comes in and none which comes out would go unnoticed. Now, I would like you to understand this here, that the ministry of the gatekeeper or the prophetic intercession, that you've got to understand that you may say that everybody is called to be an intercessor. And I believe that everybody can pray. But there are some people, Bishop, that the Holy Ghost and pick. Can I talk to you tonight? You see, you may not understand this, but if it sinks down in your spirit, then you will begin to get a burden for the word, a burden for the things of God, a burden for prayer. And you would say, God, here am I. Send me. You would say, like Isaiah, mine eyes have seen the glory of God. I'm standing in a place that I need to be used of God. So I'm making myself available. Lord, make me a gatekeeper. I don't really know how to pray, but I want to know how to pray. I don't really know how to tap in into the presence of God. But God, I want to know. I want to know. So make me a gatekeeper. Is anybody here? Is anybody here? The port has waited at every gate. They might not depart because they were available 24 hours per day from their service for their brethren, the Levites that prepared for them. It is a specific full-time calling and ministry from the Lord, just as there are other specific callings and ministry. Now, those who have the ministry of the gatekeeper intercessors or prophetic intercessors, I call that because I believe they are a part of the prophetic call in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11. That is to say, this ministry is one of the types of prophetic intercessors because they are prophetic. The prophetic intercessor is equipped by the Lord with the ability to see what is in people's heart as Jesus reveals it. God shares his secret with the intercessor. I don't hear nobody saying anything. He shares it with them because he wants them to pray about it. So they will pray according to his will as the Spirit lead. The reward of these prophetic intercessors, the joy that they got, Bishop, they will experience this joy when they see that their prayers are answered. They will rejoice. They will say, God, I've done it. I prayed like you want me to. I did what you called me to do. I stood my last. I stood at the gate. I didn't give up. Persecution come, but I never back down. Problems come, but I never back down. Sometimes I go hungry, but I still pray. Sometimes I had to do compulsory fast, but I still pray. Sometimes they talk about me, but I still pray. Sometimes they laugh at me. Can I get somebody to help me? But God, I have a prophetic intercessor. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna stand at the gate. I don't hear nobody say anything. Got somebody to tell them, don't stop. He's looking for people who will stand their ground, having the Lord to stand. You still stand. Trouble come, but you still stand. Because you know your job. Because you know your duty. They talk about you, but you still stand. They laugh at you, but you still stand. They mock you, but you still stand. God brought you through that. Then he brought you through that. If God bring you through that, he's gonna bring you through that. Touch somebody and tell them, I've got one more river to cross. I don't give up on this river. I've got one more mountain to climb. In the result of what he called me to do. I am a gatekeeper. I am a gatekeeper. I am a gatekeeper. I am a gatekeeper. So somebody tell them, keep the gate. Keep the gate. Can I get some bottom on this mic? Rabroshata. Rabayakata. Rabandosha. Rabroshata. Rabosha. Can somebody tell them, keep the gate. Keep the gate. Whatever you do, whatever you do, keep. Jesus Christ. Don't somebody tell them, keep the gate. Bishop, can I tell you to keep the gate? Because as a prophetic intercessor, what goes in, what comes out, cannot happen unless you, the gatekeeper, fall asleep. The joy of the intercessors is to see the reward after they finish praying. Bishop, can I preach? They see the results. Sometimes somebody tell them, keep the gate. Jesus, God, whatever you do, keep the gate. Don't move, don't move. Hell may pop. Demons come to you, but keep the gate. The devil will tell you it's not working. But have you seen the result of the intercession? Have you seen the results of your prayers? You see, let me tell you something. Prayers is prayers, but intercession is something different from just prayers. Anybody can pray. Oh, Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. My kingdom come. But when you are gatekeeper, nothing comes in, nothing goes out, because you have an appointment, you have an anointing to keep the gate. And you know what I'm saying? You are an appointment to be a gatekeeper. You are a prophetic intercessor. Let the devil say what he wants, but you're going to say, God, I need to see something break. So I'm going to keep the gate. I need to see victory. I'm going to keep the gate. I need to see deliverance. I'm going to keep it. The reward of such intercessors, they will see their prayers answered right before their eyes. Are you listening to me? This is prophetic ministry. So they may be sent to bring a word to those whom God shows them. As the Spirit will. It is important that the prophetic intercessor, watch this, do not take prophesying lightly. As a prophetic intercessor, don't take prophesying lightly. The reasons for that, you must not be ignorant about the prophetic ministry and understand their responsibility. In this case, is the same as a prophet. So they must be careful to be certain that they have, number one, spent time in God's presence. They must be certain, number two, that they have heard from God. And number three,
they must be certain that it is to the right person that they are sent at the right time. Otherwise, they may speak when the Lord has not sent them. I don't hear nobody singing. So that's the reason why when they were stationed at the gate, some of them had to spend the entire night. And then there were some bishop that when after 7 days, their brethren would come and release them. And so it keeps going on and on and on and on. And we're going to tie up that tonight and to show you where Isaiah comes into all of this. We got somebody and tell them, keep the gate. There's a person here now. There's a person here now. God says to tell you that you're going to have a nasty accident, but you won't die. And God said when that happens, you're going to be in the hospital for 14 days. Well, he says when you're on your back, he's going to give you 3 visions that will change your life. And when you get up from that bed, you will rise up with the power of the prophet. I don't know who it is. You see, God is not an idiot. He don't show you names sometimes because he doesn't want to scare people. But sometimes when destiny comes and for divine purposes, that things will happen. So you need to write. All you got to do is keep the gate. But somebody tell them, hold not your peace. Now watch this. The gatekeepers are a type for the prophetic intercessors of our time. The Holy Spirit will decide which anointing is required for the job that is required. So even though an intercessor might function in one or some of the anointings, most of the time the Spirit will give as he wills for the need of the moment. We must not assume that the anointings will always be the same all of the time for the individual. Also, it is important to understand that the ministries or jobs overlap. We look at the example given in the ordinance of David, and we see that certain gatekeepers was assigned to a job or a set responsibilities. Yet at times, they help each other. This shows that there is to be a teamwork amongst the intercession as needed. The chief of porters coordinated all, showing that one person coordinated it. There are groups of intercessors, and as you will find out, that God will let one of them take the lead. This is the one who knows the mind of God. Am I helping you? But God will sometimes change that person from time to time as he will for each meeting. Because it is the Spirit who should lead and not man. Anointings are transferable according to his will. This includes the leadership anointing. Now, I'm going to get into something deep here, Bishop, and show you how important it is for you to be a prophetic intercessor. Because the word of one of the gatekeepers who was chief, his name was Shalom. And Shalom means to restore, to pay retribution, to hand out deserved punishment for the evil that is done. How How many of you know, as a prophetic intercessor, you have to go into the enemy's camp and you have got to say, devil, watch out. I come to take back what you stole from me. I am a gatekeeper and I will not rest until you give back everything that you have stolen from me. So you are one of those who must pay back retribution to the powers of darkness. Are you listening to me? Another one of the gatekeepers was Akub. His name meant pursuer. To follow in order to overtake and capture. We are not to be chased by the devil, but we are supposed to chase the devil. The kingdom of God suffered violent, and the violent kicked it by force. But it's about time that the prophetic intercessors, they begin to rise. Now you've got to understand that when God says, I look for intercessors, or I set watchmen upon the wall, this is what he's talking about. He said, oh, not thy peace. Bishop, can I say what God is showing me? Because he's a person here that met in an accident a while back. And the bottom half of your back, something is wrong. It's like some parts of your back sink in and comes out. Like the vertebrae or the bottom bone of your back, just below your waist, is messed up. But God says to tell you 3 days from tonight, your back will be cured. And your walk of strength will open. Bishop, under the bush, I don't hear nobody saying anything. I don't hear nobody singing. Keep rush up to break on that side of Russia. Put somebody and tell them, keep the gate. Put somebody and tell them, keep the gate. Put somebody and tell them, take back what the devil stole from you. Because there are some of you in here tonight that the devil has come into your life and he has taken things from you. And God says to tell you that you need to take back my thoughts. You need to say, devil, everything that you take from me, I want it back. I want back my joy. I want back my peace. I want back my power. I want back my anointing. I want back my health. I want back my victory. I don't hear nobody saying anything. I don't hear nobody saying anything. Put somebody and tell them, keep the gate. Put somebody and tell them, keep the gate. Look at somebody and say, I am a gatekeeper. I am a gatekeeper. I'm gonna stand my ground. Having done all to stand. I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna have my mind filled with truth. I'm gonna have on the breastplate of righteousness. I'm gonna keep. Are you listening to me? In the devotion. The Holy Ghost is it. The Holy Ghost is it. Somebody say, keep the gate. I'm not a gatekeeper. His name was Meselemia. His name meant united with Jah, which is a short for Jehovah, for a specific purpose. So Jesus is our intercessor, but he chooses to share that burden with some of us intercessors. So sometimes God taps you on the shoulder and say, wake up, Duffus, because there is a need over here, and I want you to pray. Because God will do nothing in the earth unless somebody pray. Sometimes you want to sleep, but he said prayer time. Sometimes you want to eat, but he said put food away.
Sometimes you want to visit with your friend, but God said, not so. I'm going to join with you. And God said, listen, I want you to join with me, because Jesus is the chief intercessor. So sometimes he just grabs you by the hand and says, pray with me. Pray over this. Pray over this. Pray over this. How many of you know that the Holy Ghost is your best friend? The Holy Ghost is your best friend. The Holy Ghost, there's nothing sweeter than to have fellowship with the Holy Ghost. And sometimes he nudges you to pray. I don't care what people say. I don't care what the devil say. Call me a fanatic if you want. Call me a fool if you want. I'm a fool for Christ, but I'm gonna stand. I don't hear nobody say anything. I'm gonna stand with the Lord. I'm gonna break through until I break through. Put somebody at your push. Put somebody at your push. Put somebody at your push. 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 He needs to pray until something happens. Who knows? We should not feel that different analogy in our head. You'll be lame. You don't need to come to me. God don't want you. But he's making you whole. Oh, The woman who's believing God for pregnancy, and you're married and you've been trying for about 6 years, God said, tonight it is done. You shall conceive and bear a son.
In the name of Jesus.
Down and have a seat. Thank you.
somebody tell them I'm a gatekeeper. My next gatekeeper was JDL. His name means knowing God. An intercessor knows God. Knows the heart of God. Zebediah was another one, and I'm kind of cutting this short because I'm sensing. His name means Jah as given, or Jehovah as given. The ministry of intercession is a gift from God. We have got to stand as a gatekeeper. Another gatekeeper that stands and guard the gate, his name was Otini, means forcible. The Bible said the violent take it. Because there are some intercessors in the house of God that are using, birthing, are pushing through in prayer for the purposes of God. Another gatekeeper was Raphael, meaning God heals. There are some who will stand in the gap for people who are diseased and watch God bring healing to their lives. Another person that stand at the gate was Elam. His name means concealed or hidden. Intercession takes place behind closed doors. Then Jehovah, meaning like Jehovah. The intercessor is the one with whom God's one to share his heart. He knows God's heartbeat. I'm not true, but I'm going to quit. Shebuel was one of another gatekeeper. His name means God rescues, pulls in, or take back. This intercessor again has a specific job. To rescue, to pull in, and to take back. But when you read it for yourself, this is what you will understand. They were gatekeepers. Are the people, Bishop, that God said, give me no rest? This is what he's talking about in the book of Isaiah when he said, I set watchmen. Do you think it's the government keeping this country? It's the intercession.
Hallelujah.
It's the intercession. Every eyes closed, every head's bowed. Every eyes closed, every head's bowed. I feel the breath of God. King Shafa, Tibaba Shafa. I feel the breath of God. There's a woman here who has lupus. God said, go back to your doctor. Go back to your doctor. And let him give you another report. In the rubbish. In this great convention, Bishop, there may be one or two here tonight.
that doesn't know God and you are not saved, I'm asking you one time, let me see your hand. You're not saved. Push your hand up one time. Keep it up. Keep your hand up. Everybody that push your hand up, stand and come to me now. Come. Come. Bishop, I could say a lot more, but the Holy Ghost says, stop. Come. Bishop, last year, May, Mother's Day, I had a heart attack, you know. The doctors were surprised. Because God set intercessors in my life who would not hold their peace. When they rushed me to the, I finished preach in our church. I preach a message entitled Broken But Useful. Immediately after that I had an heart attack. They rushed me to one doctor in Oak Cherries. He said, St. Anne's Bay, they said, we can't do nothing for you. The woman said, Mrs. Black, we can't help your husband, but if you have money, his life can be saved.
Yes.
They rushed me to Montego Bay, Mobe Hope. The woman brings it up on the computer. She said, Mr. Black, this is the sign of your heart that is dead. But I've got intercessors in my life that knows how to pray. Come on, Sister Janet, you're not talking to me. I got gatekeepers. I got gatekeepers who never sleep. You don't see them, but they are hidden. They don't come out on the front and palav and show off. No, 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 no. They are hidden. But they know how to keep the gate. Bravo, shot. They know how to keep the gate. You think it's people who make noise get the job done? No, no, no. There's people that know how to keep the gate. Listen, God, we will not let go. We will not let go. We will not let go. We will not let go until the man of God. And I remember when I called and gave the news of a good report, man, God Almighty, the gatekeepers.
Hallelujah.
So she said, we got to send you to Kingston, yes, Andrews Hospital or University. They called the university hospital. They said, yes, the 22-inch wings is here waiting for him. And there was a nurse, to make a long story short, that she was a born-again, spirit-filled Christian. And she knows how to pray. And she prayed from in the ambulance, waiting to come Montego Bay to Kingston. When we reached the hospital, she came out as a Reverend Black. The Holy Ghost said to tell you all is well. I don't hear nobody say anything, but somebody tell them be a gatekeeper. The doctor says to me, we're going to put a stent in your heart or a balloon to keep your arteries open and to strain your blood. But the Holy Ghost are gatekeepers. The Holy Ghost are people who know how to keep the gate, who know how to push. Pray until something happened. When they did the angiogram on me, the man said to me, let me tell you what we did. We didn't have to put no stent in your heart because your body break up the clock by themselves. Just go back to your cardiologist and continue doing what you're doing. I don't hear nobody saying anything. I'm here to tell you.
Hallelujah.
Bishop, the last time I was with you in Canada, remember I was supposed to preach. I had to leave her. Remember you? Oh, you had to pick me up?
You remember that vision? I remember I was walking with the pastor the following morning. After you picked me up, I came to his house, stayed at his house, walking. My left leg swelled big. So big.
Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I didn't know what was happening to me. But I preach. I preached twice at their convention and I almost passed out. They had to pray me through. But I went home one night and I said, no, you gotta take me to the hospital. The hospital said, we can't help you because you don't got insurance. But you know something? I have assurance. Yeah. Hallelujah. And when I called my son the following morning, I said, listen, I'm going home. Bishop, while I was, the Holy Ghost says to me, do not walk to the door of the plane. Let them push you. I said, can I have a wheelchair? I've never ridden in a wheelchair in my life. Sister Janet, they pushed me. I could only touch my son's hand like this and said, I'll talk to you, because he came late. And when I reached the airport and they picked me up, I went to the doctor. Now, when I was at the hospital in Canada, the doctor says, listen, you don't got no insurance. You don't got no money to pay for TV. My leg is swelling, the man telling me about TV. And I came home and I went to the doctor. The doctor looked at my leg before he did any examination. He said, Mr. Black, you have a DVT in your leg. I didn't even know what that was. I said, what is that? He said, you had a blood clot in your leg. He said, you fly from Canada, he's a Cuban doctor, to Jamaica with a DVT in your leg. Are you still alive? He said, whatever you're doing for God, keep doing. Whatever you're doing, stop doing, stop doing. I lay on my back for 6 weeks under medication. And I did blood test after blood test after blood test till I was better. Because somebody kept the gate. Yes. I could share so much more testimony. But somebody kept the gate. Every eye screws, every head's down. The altar. Can you cease the music for a while? Thank you. This is the most important part of the sermon. The Bible said, if you shall believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believes and unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. All of you at this altar tonight, God loves you. He's not mad at you. He's not mad at you. He loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Listen, 30 something years ago, God delivered me from drugs. Deliver me from two unlicensed guns and and so much more. My testimony is never ending. Sister Janet, you know. But I'm here tonight. 30 some years ago, I was a Rastafarian. Now I'm a preacher. Those of you at this altar, I want you to open your mouth and say this with me. Say this with me. Dear God in heaven, I come to you tonight. I am a sinner. I need to be saved. Lord, forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your blood. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness.
I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, that he was crucified and buried and raised from the dead. I accept him into my life now as my personal Lord and Savior. Lord, save me. Save me. I repent and I ask for your mercies. I believe Christ died for my sins according to the scriptures. Thank you for hearing me pray and for answering me.
From Chi-Town to your town. Yeah.
Got some angels watching over me.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.